Hello all, and welcome to another episode of the Market Pulse presented by Smart Touch. I am your host, Aaron Fichera, and today I have a very special guest with us, Gary Davis, the founder and president of First Advisors, Inc., one of the major groundbreaking real estate developers here in Central Texas in the Hill Country. Gary, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Aaron. Very, very proud to be a part of your podcast.
Well, we got quite a adventure of topics we're going to cover today. You know, Gary, with your background in the Hill Country, especially Brownwood being, you know, kind of near and dear to my heart, being a Stephenville native, I anticipate us talking through the whole gamut of through your experience over 50 plus years in the real estate game. How has Texas shaped the importance of water and resources in current development, state and local politics, and how those are influencing developers like yourself, as well as just demographic changes? Our state is changing dramatically from when you started your career to the problems we face today and for future generations. So I hope to kind of look over the whole, again, gamut of it. So I appreciate it. And I do have to mention something. Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you very much.
You turned 71 earlier in the week, so happy
birthday.
What's your secret?
Well, there's a cliche that says age is a subject of the mind only. I can tell you quickly that that is not necessarily true, but I have been blessed to be able to deal with any health issues that have confronted me, and my mind is still young, so I do think it plays a major role. I'm not saying it's dominant, but hey, as long as my mind is good and I'm able to be mobile and all, I'm going to keep going. So
I love it. So, well, what I always start off with is that we're going to turn the clock back. How did it all begin? Where did the career begin, and how did it all start for Gary Davis in real estate?
Well, I would say that my interest in real estate was really sparked by my maternal grandmother and my mother's uncles, and also my late father and mother, whom were in some area of the real estate business going all the way back to the 1940s through the 1980s. So that's a pretty big span. It's a generation, a couple of generations, actually. So you might say that real estate is in the family. It has been. I'm the third generation of our family to be in real estate. And my son, Clifton, is the fourth generation. He's my youngest son, and he's worked with me since 2005 and is now a partner with me in our real estate development and investment businesses. So, anyway, going back to the beginning to address your question, my career started in 1973. I was very young, and I decided to pursue a career in real estate instead of pursuing a business degree and a law degree at Baylor University. I did attend Baylor University for 1 year, but I love Baylor University. But let's just say that I was not a fit for Baylor. Baylor might have been a fit for me if I'd have given it a better shot, but I was not a fit for Baylor at that time. So anyway, that's how it came about. And so I decided to, I wanted to go into the real estate business with my father, and both he and my mother accepted my decision a little grudgingly at first, but they then quickly enough supported it 100%. And so our county seat, which was Gatesville, the county seat of Corio County, we had a small town real estate firm that was engaged in general real estate brokerage, development and residential subdivisions in Corio County, and then commercial land development and home building in Central Texas, which included not only the Gatesville area, but Coppers Cove, Killeen, Belton, that area of Texas. So that went great for a while. And then something happened that really changed my trajectory and career path. And so I want to tell you about it and your listeners.
Please.
In the spring of 1980, I was fortunate to form a relationship with former Texas Governor John Connally and former Lieutenant Governor Ben Barnes, also with their other business partner. They had a third business partner whose name is Herman Bennett. And Herman was a general contractor and developer with a headquarters in Brownwood, Texas, and they had regional offices in Houston and in Austin. So I started with them, and they begged me to start. They would say differently, but they really wanted me to go to work for them. And I decided that it was about a whole lot more than the meager paycheck that they were offering me at the time. But I had just gotten remarried, and the steady paycheck was very appealing to my wife at the time, who had also been in real estate. So we said, let's do it. Let's see what happens. And we did. And after 6 months of working as a vice president of leasing in the company's shopping center division, I was appointed to be the director of the shopping center division of their company, which was a really big step for me. So then, and I was based out of Houston most of the time, and we were building shopping centers all over the state of Texas. So it was a very engaging, work day and work week. And it just kind of blurred the, you'd work all day and 15, 16 hours a day, and it would turn into a full week, and then a month would go by, and you just seemed like it was just a blur almost looking back. It was an exciting time. So in 1982, I pivoted within the company and formed a new division, and was appointed as the director of the multifamily division for the Barnes-Conley partnership, and was supervising the development and the financing of 12 apartment projects that were located in 9 cities in Texas. So I supervised all of that and got everything up to the point of where it was ready to start construction. I had all of the financing committed and closed. The plans were approved by the local jurisdictions. Everything had been bid out, was ready to go and pull the trigger. And I must say that all was accomplished in a very short period of time. And it had the result of burning me out. I just got totally burned out. I went to Mexico for a week. Mr. Barnes tracked me down, found the phone number, probably bribed my secretary to give the phone number to him in the villa where I was staying, and called me and said, when are you coming back? And I said, I don't know. I haven't decided yet. And he laughed, and he said, so can I assume you are coming back? And I said, again, I'm just trying to reflect and contemplate on what I'm going to do. And he said, well, on the assumption you do come back, please call me as soon as you arrive. Well, I did. And he said, I think I know what you're going to say. And I said, yeah, it's time for me to go on a new adventure. And he didn't like hearing that, but he respected it. And so that's what I did. And Governor Barnes and I have had a very cordial, warm relationship since that time. And we've even continued our business relationship, and we're business partners to this day. So anyway, it worked out great. And so that's what I did. I left in the summer of 1983. And with some other Austin investors, I formed a commercial mortgage brokerage firm in Austin. And the firm specialized in multifamily lending. And we had out-of-state clients primarily, and those clients developed and built apartment projects in 14 states in the U.S. So I was traveling constantly. I was going to New York, Washington, California, a lot of places.
So you thought you were not going to get burned out, and then you doubled down.
I thought I was not going to get burned out, and here I am on a plane twice a week. And so you know, in the fast lane once again.
Yeah.
So I did that, and then we decided to take a detour. And so then from 1989 to 1992, I ended up working as an asset manager and an advisor to a Dallas-based company that owned literally 99 shopping centers in the southeast and southwestern United States. They didn't own 100. They didn't own 98. They owned 99. It was not planned that way, but
I was going to say, is there some sort of
superstition? It was not superstition. It was not purposeful. It was just by chance that they ended up with this huge portfolio. And so we took on a big chunk of that portfolio and did asset management work for them. I'm speaking of myself and another business partner of mine based out of College Station who had been a longtime shopping center developer. His name was John Culpepper. And the Culpepper family is so iconic in not only College Station in Bryan, Texas, but all over the state of Texas, and had this very, very special relationship with Walmart. So that's a whole nother story. But I can tell you this, that in 1980, hardly anybody in the state of Texas knew who Walmart was.
Yeah.
They were a small firm that had started in Bentonville, Arkansas, and they had decided to expand into the state of Texas. So, but again, that's for another time. So I don't want to get off track here, but I'll save that for maybe some other day. So that's what I did until 92. Then in 1992, Herman Bennett, the original partner with Governor Connally and Governor Barnes, approached me, and we acquired a very substantial land tract for commercial development in Brownwood, because he was still residing in Brownwood and had his offices there. And we ended up and made a deal with Walmart, and Walmart built a super center in Brownwood, Texas. Now that doesn't seem like anything that's remarkable today, but I can tell you that in 1992, it was remarkable because the super center that was built on our land in Brownwood was super center number 9. I've lost track of how many super centers that Walmart has built in the United States, but it's hundreds and hundreds. You know, you can hardly go anywhere and not see that format of a store for them. So, we thought that they had a great store. Mr. Bennett had built a new store for them 5 years previous. That was 80,000 square feet, which we thought was very, very large. It was, but they informed us we have a new format, and it's called a super center. We said, okay, wow, well, what is a super center? We didn't know, and we'd been in the shopping center business. And they said, well, it's this big store. Well, how big is big? Define that for us. And they said, it's 210,000 square feet. So,
basically 3x what
exactly. It was astounding to us, but we assembled the land, accommodated them. They built a store on our land, and we transacted with them and had all this extra land. The significance of that store coming to Brownwood is not to be overlooked, because the sales tax that was created from that store opening in Brownwood at one point in time, in the early years, represented about 25% of the total city budget. So it had an outsized impact on the city budget of Brownwood, which was a big deal. And speaking candidly, I think probably created some chips for us to store up to use with the city of Brownwood in the future.
Probably there's a little bit of goodwill.
We thought it might. So anyway, that's what we did. And as though that's not enough, I had an opportunity through an attorney friend of mine, and we formed a new mortgage banking firm in Austin that specialized in FHA insured home improvement loans. And we had researched the market and felt like that there was a big gap and a big opportunity to do this with a veteran group of mortgage bankers that had been running a similar type firm in Lake Jackson, Texas. And we were able to recruit that whole management team and relocate that team from Lake Jackson, Texas to Austin. And we started this company. It did very well. And I was the vice chairman, one of the founders. And we took the company public in 1996. And then subsequently in 97 and 98, I sold my interest in the company. And then from 98 until 2001 or two, for about a 3 or 4 year period, I began sponsoring investment partnerships that really targeted financial services companies and technology companies in Austin. That period of time was when technology companies, a lot of software companies especially, were leveraging the widespread acceptance and scaling of the internet, if you recall. And so it was a heyday of technology. So that's what I did. Then in, I'll have an end to this. Just bear with me. I'm almost there.
No. Please.
It's to some people, my family who's heard the story 100 times, probably at least. It's a saga, but they always are interested in hearing it one more time. So, and for people, I tell it to you the first time, they want to hear it again. So who knows? But then in 2002, I returned to the real estate development sector full time, and I proceeded to the development with the development of the remaining commercial and residential land holdings that we owned in Brownwood, Texas at that time. And I also purchased a very large community shopping center in Brownwood that had coincidentally been built by Mr. Bennett in 1968. So here I am in 2000,
the full circle.
Full circle, 2002, purchasing, or actually in 2003, purchasing that shopping center, renovating the center, completely renovating, and then I subsequently sold it, or my partnership and I, because I had some Brownwood investment partners, and we sold that shopping center to a publicly traded real estate investment trust, which owns it to this day. So it's been a very successful center for a long, long time, in sort of an anchor retail area in Brownwood. So to sort of recap and finalize all this and take a breath here, during my career, what's remarkable, I look back and I participated as either a division director, a director of a division within a company. I've acted as a fee developer on behalf of other investors, or I have been a principal and sponsored myself real estate projects in 27 cities in Texas. So my activities of investing and developing land in Brownwood continues to this day. I'm back in Brownwood, and I have a relationship with this community that goes back to all the way back to 1980. And for another time, I can explain why I chose Brownwood over all of the many other cities in Texas that offer opportunity, but there's just a story in itself to that city.
Listen, this is the point, is I would love to capture this, you know. Now, I know people from Stephenville, because Stephenville and Brownwood have a rivalry, you know, burn the wood, as it was back in the day.
Yes.
But no, why Brownwood? Because Brownwood sits, for those that are unfamiliar, you know, with the Hill Country, it sits on the kind of the northern, northwest point of the Hill Country, kind of the northern Hill Country. Why did you find that was the most opportune place for development? And still?
Aaron, I tend to use metaphors and analogies in everything I describe and in the way I communicate with people. And the analogy, the answer that I will communicate to you as sort of an analogy here is it's sort of like a three-legged stool or four-legged stool. So for brown wood, the first leg of the stool is the location of the of brown wood in the context of its proximity to other cities, other major metropolitan areas in the state of Texas. Specifically, Brownwood is within a 3 hour or less driving distance to Midland, Odessa, and the other West Texas markets. It is within a 3 hour driving distance to DFW Airport, the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, and to the airport itself. It is within about a 2.5 hour drive to the Waco, Temple, Killeen, metropolitan area in along I-35 corridor. You drop down to Austin, it's within a 3 hour drive from downtown Austin to Brownwood. And then you can go even all the way to northern part of San Antonio, and you take a different route, obviously, but it's about a 3 hour drive to Brownwood from there. So excluding Houston, it's 3 hours from everywhere. And it's a small county seat, rural town, but it's really a little regional trading center for about a 7-county region at the northern edge of the top of the Texas Hill Country, as you mentioned. And so it has a job base, an industrial job base, which for many decades in the U.S., as we lost so many industrial jobs, Brownwood has had more industrial jobs at one time than the city of Abilene, a city that's 5 times the population of Brownwood. So it's always had a good job base. It's been centrally located. That's one leg of the stool. The second leg of the stool, which is so important, and increasingly will become more important, is that it has an abundance of water. The reason it has an abundance of water is because of Lake Brownwood, which was built in the 1920s. So it's not a new lake. But it has a watershed that is much, much larger than many lakes that are 2 or 3 times the size of Lake Brownwood. So it tends to stay at a level. It's not a constant level lake the way it's built, but it tends to hold water and keep water and be able to have water come into it because of the watershed, when a lot of the other surface lakes in Texas don't have that benefit. They're really relegated to one tributary to feed water to the lake. And so Brownwood stays at a higher level most of the time than all of the other lakes that you can look at in Texas. So the other big thing about this lake is, for comparison, I live on Upper Lake Travis. And so in the Austin metropolitan area, as you know, it's the population now of the metro is about 2.4 million people. But if you look at what the population base is that draws their water from Lake Travis, that's about 2 million people. So in comparison,
a lot of thirsty mouths.
It's a lot of straws in Lake Travis, which is a whole big, different, separate discussion for another day. But Lake Brownwood is about half the size of Lake Travis. However, it only supports a population base of 50,000 people. So it has so much room for growth, to accommodate growth. Not that anyone in their right mind anticipates Brown County and Brownwood blowing up in with population like has happened in along the I-35 corridor in Central Texas and part of the Texas Triangle region. But it has, the point is, they have an abundance of water. And that is, and that's reliable, and that's so important. So that's the second leg of the stool. The third leg of the stool is really, given the proximity of Brownwood to these metropolitan areas, the shift and change in demographics over time there's just so many more high net worth households in the metropolitan areas because of the job opportunities that have been created in Texas, because of the advances in technology and with the tech jobs that pay, as you know, the scale of pay at a technology firm is so much higher typically. And so we have these wealthy households, and then also these households, if they're not of the baby boomer generation, they are of Gen X, and they are starting to inherit the wealth of their baby boomer parents that was accumulated. So a lot of wealth being created in Texas, and those people are looking for an escape to a country town, a quaint country town atmosphere that is within a reasonable driving proximity of where they currently live, in some metropolitan area of the DFW market, Central Texas market, Austin Metro, even San Antonio, and then to the west, to the Midland Odessa area. They're looking for a place to escape and perhaps have a second home that they can enjoy on weekends, holidays, for family gatherings, and then over time grow into that home as their primary residence as they approach retirement age. So that's sort of the third leg of the stool. So with the location, the abundance of water, and the wealth being created, Brownwood is really, really very attractive. And of course, they have a lot going for it in their own city. They have invested a lot of money in a downtown renovation. There are a lot of boutiques that have sprung up and opened up shop in downtown Brownwood, brew pubs, wine bars, restaurants, the whole vibe, the whole scene that everybody is looking for, but the quaintness is still there. So it has all of these elements. That's, you know, kind of the whole reason Brownwood is attractive to me anyway.
And ironically, those are the subjects we're going to be talking about. So it's almost as if the stars align, because based on the stools of location and the demographic shifts that accommodate that, the influence of local and state economic development, and then finally water rights, which I think is a perfect segue into our next segment, which is water. It is the fundamental building block of life. Without it, we have no development. So
that's right.
You know, have no people. So, you know, water being a crucial factor in any land development project, particularly in the Hill Country, how do developers like yourself assess that feasibility, sustainability, and then plan for the different product types? You know, what would be for maybe ranch community or commercial or multifamily is going to be different water usage and feasibility studies for, say, golf courses, which are, you know, historically water suckers, for lack of a better word.
They are, in fact. So the answer is, it's very process driven. So it really starts with having a study commissioned and doing an analysis and quantification of the amount of water that's going to be used by the specific land development project that's under consideration. And that study really be focused on a long period of time, let's say 50 years or so, because you can't give it short shrift and say, okay, do we have enough water to last 20 years? You need to really plan. Most water studies will go out and project out at least for 50 years. Then you have to do another analysis of the ability of the water supplier to serve the project over the projected 50-year period. So typically a water supplier, which would be either a city, a municipality, or it could be a water district. In many cases, water districts are formed and own the actual lakes, the surface lakes. Or it could be a water supply company that is buying water from a surface lake at a wholesale rate and then retailing that water to the customers. Whichever is the case, there has to be an analysis of that entity that will be the source of the water. and determine if they have sufficient water to supply the project with over the projected period of time. Now, water can come from places other than surface lakes, to be sure, and it does. I mean, many cities still utilize water wells. Most of the cities that utilize well water or water wells, they're drawing water from an underground aquifer in the area if they're not drawing the water from a surface lake that's located in the area. But the aquifers are getting lower and lower and less reliable, and so for a number of reasons. So anyway, the availability of water in Texas to serve future growth is really now at the forefront of critical infrastructure issues that are being analyzed by not only local governments, but state governments as well. And there are regions of Texas where water is at a critical shortage, just to serve existing residents and businesses without having any ability to serve any new growth. So with the effects of climate change, I think that water will remain at the forefront of infrastructure needs by pretty much all cities and towns in Texas, so they can assess what their ability will be to serve future population growth and over the next 50, even 75 years in the state of Texas. And just to add to that, there's actually an article that came out that I noted. It was in the Austin American Statesman. It was published 2 days ago on September the 10th. And what's remarkable about this article is how much water the cities, the various municipalities lost through their leaky infrastructure, their leaky pipes. So there's a lot of waste of water, of treated water. And I'll just run down the list. So in 2023, there was a study done by the Texas Tribune, and the largest cities in Texas lost approximately 88 billion, and that's billion with a B, gallons of water because of the aging infrastructure that they have and the extreme heat. And it resulted in millions of dollars in cost, and it really stressed the state's already limited water supply. And this was self-reported by the city. So going down the list, Houston, Texas lost 31.8 billion gallons of water in 23. San Antonio, 19.5 billion. Dallas, 17.6 billion. Austin, 7.1 billion. Fort Worth, 5.9 billion. And El Paso, 4.8 billion. I mean, these are just astounding statistics, just reported 2 days ago, by the way, coincidentally. And so there's all kinds of conservation measures that are going to have to be enacted throughout the state of Texas, because we just cannot afford to waste water in the way it's being wasted right now. And this leaky infrastructure is going to have to be addressed, but it's not a quick fix. It takes a lot of money, and it takes a long time to fix the all of the different water pipes running in these metropolitan areas.
Well, before we kind of jump into a little bit of that private-public partnership, it sounds like challenges that we face right now in the management, the development is around infrastructure or existing infrastructure versus new build. And then the limitations of our aquifers. I mean, do you see any other significant challenges that you face when it comes to water and trends that, you know, we should be already thinking about?
Well, I do. I actually do, because I think, you know, sometimes we, as developers and as stewards of government units, whether it be a city or a county or a state planning organization or even at state government, I mean, we We don't pay adequate attention. I think we take for granted a resource that we've always had and had plenty of. And so now it's, you know, this is, some people would say, wow, I didn't realize we're at such a critical stage. And so there needs to be an educational campaign to get really the general public engaged in this so they are aware and then can realize that we have to do something. So, for example, in many areas of Texas right now, it's really difficult for a developer to obtain what we refer to as a will serve letter, meaning you go to a city or a water supplier and say, I need for my lender and my investors, I need a letter that says that you will, quote, that you, quote, will serve my project with water and based on an analysis of the project. So that's called a will serve letter. But those are very hard to get now, much harder to get than they were even 4 or 5 years ago. Most of these areas are behind in building out infrastructure or repairing existing infrastructure to serve this population growth that we've been experiencing the last, especially the last 4 years since the onset of COVID. So it's not uncommon for a water entitlement for a proposed development project to take 24 months and sometimes longer from the time that a developer submits this request until such time as you receive a commitment to serve the project. That's a long time just to get a commitment for water. This adds to the pre-construction development phase of a project, and as a result, it adds to the increased cost of the project to have to be waiting this long. So the only way really to mitigate these challenges for a developer like myself is to start very early on a pre-construction development phase of a project so that on a timeline, you're well in advance of the projected construction start date. So again, this adds to the timeline for the work that's needed and adds to the expense prior to the construction start. This is one of the big challenges that we're facing as developers. Longer time.
I mean, is it just getting to a point where it just elongates it so much that it doesn't even make it worthwhile?
Well, for some people it does. It obviously, you know, it requires a lot of patience. And if you don't have the patience, will you drop out and you go somewhere where you think you can get a quicker will serve letter for water? But it costs money and time.
Well, and from your experience, do you feel this kind of reluctance or this slowdown is just years of local bureaucracy, or is it by design to slow this down in order to protect water and resources?
No, I think generally the areas that, and I've worked in so many areas, the areas that I've worked in are generally receptive to growth. They're not anti-growth. There are some areas in Texas perhaps that are anti-growth, but they're very much in the minority. In most areas, the local governments are receptive to growth, but they just simply don't have the capacities to serve the amount of growth that we've been experiencing in Texas. I mean, we've had such an in-migration in Texas of population from other states, people relocating from other, it's really happening. I mean, people from the Northeast are moving to Texas for a variety of reasons. For some of the same reasons, people are relocating from California to Texas. And so we're experiencing a population increase more so today in Texas from in-migration from other parts of the United States than from just organic natural childbirths. The you look at the statistics of childbirths compared to deaths, and it's pretty much a break-even proposition. We don't have more childbirths than deaths. We have about the same in either category. So the only population increases we're experiencing in Texas, and this is not unique to Texas, this is in other areas of the country as well, is we either have in-migration or we have legal immigration. Now, some people would suggest, well, we have so much illegal immigration, but I'm not convinced that the illegal immigration is near as big a factor as maybe it's been politicized to be. In fact, the studies show that our illegal immigration only represents 13% of the total immigration into the country. So 87% of the people who are coming here from outside the U.S. are coming legally. So, I mean, that's, you know, that's another one of these things that's been politicized. So,
yeah, it's more nuanced than just, you know,
right.
what can right. be put on a bumper sticker.
Yeah. Now, it's remarkable, though, because there are some parts of the United States that are showing declines in population that had never shown any declines before. So there's a lot that goes into the mix. But Texas, fortunately, for those of us who have chosen to be Texans and citizens of the state and reside here and do business here, we're showing a lot of in-migration at the expense of some other areas of the United States.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
I
don't expect it to slow down.
No.
Yeah.
Right. I expect that trend to continue, frankly. I really do.
No, I think just like the factors that outlined in Brownwood and what's attractive on a very local level and the different environments and people and culture and just swaths of opportunities, you know, it's enticing. And for someone who's a student of history, especially studying Texas history, good or bad economic times, Texas has usually prevailed.
Yes, it has. I would agree.